and such like things that had happened, that happens even in any civil engineering project or a mechanical engineering project. Okay. So, I mean, I'll come back and we will visit this Hello World program again after some, in a few minutes. Okay. What happened? Okay. Now, so why do you think, Sudha, are you able to see this slide?
Yes, ma'am.
So why in software, you know, we have these issues or why it actually comes? Okay, technical things I'll just tell. Basically, you all must be going through some requirements of the software that actually is coming, and then there's an implementation. Now the issues actually come when the requirements and the implementation, they don't actually overlap. So you can see this, I have actually given a pictorial representation of requirements here in this blue line, and then the implementation in the green line dotted or whatever. And then when they don't overlap, you will have bugs. So the requirement bugs will be there, and then the implementation issues will actually come as security problems. So if you understand this particular concept, then it's easy actually to go ahead in my next portion of the talk. Okay, so in that, what happens, we'll have to actually understand why in software more and more of these kind of issues and all come. In fact, I think 16th November, if I'm not mistaken, 16th November, some Android phone, some cybersecurity issue also has come up. So when these kind of cybersecurity issues are already coming up, we need to actually understand why these problems actually come. And today, everything is software. You ask a mechanical engineer person, he will tell he's working in software. So we were asking why, how the hell it happens? He said, no. You see, we are building this specified thing for some aircraft, and then that particular thing, we have to actually design this entire thing using some software called Catia. I mean, I'm just giving an example. So it has now become all encompassing, inclusive portion of our lives. So we have to understand why these issues, errors. See, if there is a requirement error, yes, somebody can go and take care of that. But then if there is a just give me a minute, sir. There's a lot of noise here.
No pain. I have a meeting here. Don't shout here. No, don't pain.
Meeting. So we have to understand why these issues and all come up. One of the things is, in today's world, okay, everything is extensible. Now, if you just care to go rewind a bit back, initially we only had one dial phone. Okay, so we used to dial those 10 digits and then we used to pick up the phone and talk. Now and then in that phone, we had started having some messages coming in. Then we had to started having radio. Then we started having video. We started having, all that happened, alarm, everything. Earlier you had one alarm clock, one radio, everything now coming into one small handheld device. Then after these candy bar phones went off, yes, we all use these candy bar phones also. We started getting these smartphones, which has got those Android OS and all that. So everything is getting extended. You just have to download one more app from the Play Store and then start, utilizing it. Now, when this extensibility goes on and on and on, obviously, at the interfaces of each and every application, there are so many things that if it doesn't take care, it is going to actually produce a lot of unwanted errors, unwanted issues that we'll have to face. The next thing is complexity. This is where I told I'll come back to the Hello World. Okay. Now, what is happening in this today's unbridled growth in these computing systems? And I'll just give you an example. in when this Hello World program was actually thought of by our founding fathers for C and CP, Morley, Cunningham and Ritchie, they actually wanted to teach us just to write a Hello World program, it takes a compiler, it takes an editor, and then it takes some little bit of grammar or understanding of the C, and then only you can actually put, and then it will come out. And it is not just I put a Hello World and then in the terminal it starts glowing. They wanted to actually understand, in order to build a small program like that, what are all the other building blocks that we need. But what has happened is, it was supposed to be for beginners, but then actually it requires suspiciously lot of things, complicated process, lot of moving parts. You will be surprised to know that just to write a Hello World program in Java, okay, and using Maven, it takes some 1350 files into more than 550 directories. And then if supposing there's some React things, so some React JS and things like the JavaScript is there. If you start writing a Hello World in that, that takes around 4304 directories and my God, a whooping 28K files. Okay, now if supposing just to print that Hello World two words, you are actually going to get this many files. What each of these files are doing, why all these things are happening, we need to understand. It is getting complexer and complexer. So one is extensibility, one is complexity. Just to write one Hello World program, we are having this many files. And as you know, now today any application actually is on the internet. It is connected. I don't know how many applications I had to use to open one. I have the Microsoft PowerPoint application. Then I had it's all very easy, so to speak, these days. Trying to connect from the comfort of my home and get this talk. But then with that, you have to take it to the pinch of salt. There are prone to come any number of issues. We don't want anybody get crashing into these kind of issue talks and things like that. So how does it happen? How does it? Can it happen? Yes, it can happen. How does it happen? That is the thing of this particular talk. And then connect the other corner or the trinity of the trouble is the connectivity. Everything and everyone wants to be connected. App, a simple Google Meet app wants to have connection into your contacts, to your microphone, to your camera. Fine, it is required. But then, do you know that whether the camera and the microphone is off after you are switching off, or is it always going to be default? Yes, we don't know. That is something that may leak. Issues may leak, security problems may cause all sorts of problems for us. Okay, now we saw this. Then let's begin to understand why these causes, there are these causes of errors. Okay, there are various stages in the software development. Okay, I'll just come to that in a bit, maybe explain pictorially. Requirements, gathering, then designing, then coding, testing, maintenance, and so on. It's a huge life cycle. Okay, the issue is, because it is software and it is because it is so easy to take your computer on it, switch on, write a few lines of code, save, build, and run, you think that it is so easy. Yes, it is easy, but then it is an engineering thing, so we need to actually understand, if you are changing something somewhere here, what are the repercussions that is actually having earlier in the life, earlier in the flow of the software and later on also. Many of us don't actually do this particular thing. You imagine the same thing happening in a mechanical engineering kind of thing. Supposing you are building a civil engineering kind of thing. Supposing you are actually building a bridge two banks of the river. And there are so many things that you will do. It is not like halfway that you go and build the civil engineering structure or something like that. You will say, no, this is not correct. Do this or do that. And bells and whistles and all those nice jing bangs and all will come later on. But initially, the basic, the foundation stones and all have to be set properly. And that is where you will actually get a very robust bridge, which will span the river, and it will keep working for its functionality, that is connecting two ends for transportation purpose, and it will continue to be there for any number of years. But supposing you want to go and change mechanical engineering design when it is actually 3/4 into the thing, or you want to go and change when it is actually being constructed or something like that, there is a cost involved in breaking that structure. There is a cost involved in breaking that bridge or building or mechanical engineering, that entire whatever framework that you have made to stand up. So unfortunately, or without thinking consciously, in software, everybody says, you go and click that mouse there. Yeah, click wo menu aa jayega, usme se you do that. And then, you go and put this, fix this or patch this and things like that. Okay. Now, a parallel to the mechanical or the, civil engineering field, supposing there is a water leak or something like that, which we have not identified the root cause, you can just go put a cement, white cement or something. But sometime later, again, the water will leak and, it will cause a lot of damages. The same kind of thing applies to software. It is not that you have to have patches. Patches will create, but you know what kind of a patchy software will actually, or a patchy product will actually look? It is going to ruin our lives, or it is going to cause us a lot of issues. Okay. Now, when I am telling about the causes of software at each stage, requirement, design, and programming, at each stage, if we are not taking care of the issues or of how it will actually manifest, then it will, if and how it has to be addressed, then it will lead to errors in the software. Okay. Now, suppose there is an issue with the implementation only. Only with the implementation. Is it going to be very difficult to find out that there is not going to be any design issue and it is only going to be in the implementation? Yes, it will going to be easier to do that. But supposing in the design, we have actually forgotten to take care of something. Okay. Now, but we have gone and implemented something in the implementation and you correct the implementation, but actually the root cause lies in the design, then that is going to be disastrous. So, many of these things have to be handled early in the life cycle of the software development. Now, let me just give you the thing, software development life cycle. Okay. In fact, I have put a cube of cheese with a lot of holes here. I just wanted to show you at each stage, I'll just come to the picture in a while in the next slide. At each stage, the requirements, the design specification, implementation, testing, all these things are, they are actually having a lot of holes. So many of the errors can actually pass through these holes. So I'll just show you. Sometimes a picture speaks 1,000 words. So I just wanted to give you this picture of a cheese. So if you can see here, there's this requirements, and then there's a specification, functional semantics, problematic specification, then programmer, knowledge attention strategies, programming system, interface information, then program itself, algorithm, data structures, and so on and so forth. So from requirements, the issues are problematic specification. From programmer, it is something to do with cognitive breakdown. From programming system, it's some usability issues. From program, it is software errors. And these actually go into runtime faults and runtime failures. So what happens is, like you can see, each of these things is looking to me. I mean, when I was actually going through a lot of research to make this particular program, it looked to me like a, cheese with a lot of holes. And therefore, I came up with that idea to show that, if at each stage it is going to be that the errors are actually, so some requirement is there, which has not been captured by any of these things. And since the requirement is not captured and implemented, it will give to some random persons. So this is very important in order to address. And so that is one of the things, that there is a creep. You see, there is something which is actually coming from the requirement stage, not addressed, design stage, not addressed, implementation stage, not addressed, then it goes on. Okay. Now, then let's actually see into the categorization of errors. So having said this particular thing about, all these errors that are creeping, most of the times what happens is, I'll give you a very simple example. Most of the time what happens is, when we are telling that I have built this particular software to do a particular functionality, we only go and test for that particular functionality. Okay. We don't actually go and see whether something else, it is supposed to do only this and nothing else. That is what they say when we are talking about software security. Okay. Now, I can ask the question, maybe you can keep that as a quiz. What is the difference between software security and security software? Okay. Now, software security is some security software. Let's actually try to do that. security software could be your firewall, an encryption algorithm, an antivirus, okay, application, or it could be, you know, some message digest and such like things. But each of those applications that I mentioned now actually have to be implemented using some programming language. Now, if supposing I am writing my encryption algorithm using C and I actually mess up with all the, you know, the implementation issues and things like that, then my encryption algorithm, the way I have implemented itself, may give rise to security problems. So therefore, that is software security and this is security software. Okay, so if the security software is not implemented properly in software, that gives rise to your software security issues. So where were we? We were actually talking about how we have a requirement and we have actually a implementation for it, and we will actually go and test whether this requirement is built, is actually taken care by this implementation by doing some testing. But do we actually do all the tests? Is it possible to do all the tests all the time? Not every time, okay? Especially if it is going to be an aerospace related software, which is going to go on an airline and things like that, they have very strict standards and stringent standards where something known as DO-178B and DO-178C, where these kind of implementation issues cannot actually enter into the software manufacturing pipeline. Now, just to give a small example, okay, supposing I go to a shop and I buy a lock, okay, and a key. Now, what happens is I'll just give you an analogy. When I do a functional testing, I only take the 4 set of keys and I open the lock and I check, yeah, this keys are opening up this lock, closing this lock, fine. But will I check with the rest of the keys available in the shop that when I lock this with this key, okay, I cannot open this lock with any of the other keys? Now that is what is actually going to be called as security testing. We do functional testing of the software as regards with the whatever functionality it is written, fine. But do we do security testing? We don't do security testing. And that is also one of the reasons why the software, errors and so many other things and all keep creeping. Okay. So let's actually go into the, there are so many errors out there in the landscape of software. So actually let's go and understand the categorization of the errors. Okay. The categorization of errors for each of this, I'll give you some few points and examples. First one is the lack of secure software development lifecycle processes. The second one is on knowledge issues. Third comes up technological issues, psychological issues, design flaws with serious repercussions. Okay. Now, lack of secure software development processes. Actually, we are trying to put the cart before the horse. Okay. Now, when you're not clearly articulating the requirements and you're actually failing to communicate. Now, this is one of the reasons that when you fail to communicate your requirements properly, actually causes a lot of this thing, and also modifying someone else's code. And this is prevalent in the software industry. And then next, software industry has got unrealistic development time because nobody understands that I'm giving a analogy from the civil engineering, mechanical engineering field, because supposing we want to build a building, we will say once we put a roof, we need about 3 hours, three weeks of curing time. Okay, we'll put water and then it'll set and everything like that. After that, we don't build the next floor at all. No, that at all is actually those processes and those timelines and all are very, very beautifully captured over, because these engineering fields and all are more than 200, 300, maybe more than that many years of old. However, software is very, very nascent. It is hardly 50, 20, 25, 30 years old only. So people think that it's just, you are just going to use a computer, write some code, and then you give me the thing. So unrealistic development time. Then poor design logic. We don't know, because somebody wants to actually build a swing, but then he ends up doing something else. So the design logic is not there. Poor coding practices, pathetic coding practices, because we think that hello world means everything we would be able to do. then the major disastrous thing is lack of version control. Now, when I called about version control, please understand this version control thing, especially so in the medical field, especially if you go to your pharmacist and ask medicine, now he will be very, very this thing, how he will give the medicine. He will, when he cuts that strip also, he will ensure that the batch number and date with him is actually correct, and then he'll cut and give you. Because tomorrow some legal problem comes, he should not be actually caught. Okay, that much, that version control is actually, ingrained into his psyche. But then in software, we are notorious for not keeping the version control. And therefore, because in software, it is easy to change anything. And you will change, you will not know what repercussions that particular software this thing has changed, and what disastrous consequences it is going to have. And then it all hell will break loose. In fact, I was reading to some blog today where there's this professor, and he was ensuring that when he does his first Hello World class, he makes sure that his students actually understand that open source this thing called Git bit. So he says, using that initially itself, when you make the students, you know, aware of it, of the thing of version control, then these kind of things can be taken care. Then I said about inadequate security testing. I think I explained to you what the analogy of a security testing is in terms of using that lock and key. And therefore, if that is not done, then we have a lot of problems there. And the next we were talking is about knowledge issues. Okay, the thing is, we actually focus only on the functional, okay, but we don't actually focus on the non-functional issues in that software, what it is not supposed to do or what it is supposed to do. And I mean, there are so many other things. Lack of knowledge in the sense, we may not know about the domain or something like that. For example, I'll give you in fact, there is this thing about lack of knowledge, maybe even in the using phase also. There was this famous thing about this Therax, some X-ray machines or something like that, which was actually used for treating cancer patients. Okay, now what had happened was there was this that was more in the usability, but just I thought that example was very good. There was this particular thing where it was a pause or proceed, but both the buttons were the same. Okay, and it was designed by some software person, the entire software and hardware and things like that, but it was used by medical radiologists. Medical radiologists, they don't know, right? So there was some problem there, and because of that, what had happened was, instead of giving some 10x dose of that radiation, people were given 10 multiplied by so many, 4 times or 5 times that thing, which is actually very detrimental, and many patients actually died also. This happened in the 80s. You can actually go and look up Therax, Therax issues with respect to it is also one of the very well documented software disasters that actually has happened. Incidentally, one more paper that comes to my mind is there's this nice paper in IEEE Reliability, if I'm not taken that, called Software Catastrophes. Okay, IEEE is it's a collection of software catastrophes that also you people can actually look into. And then you overly trust, then there are antiquated mean very old paradigms and issues with the programming languages chosen. For example, when we are choosing a programming language, supposing we are choosing C, we know that there are issues with pointers and things like that. But then, or we are going to use some other language, then each of these programming languages also inherently bring a lot of implementation errors that needs to be taken care of. Okay, now, this is the technological issues. Reuse of vulnerable components and codes. Okay, now the first this thing, what has happened, I'll give you an anecdotal thing. Like I mentioned, in 1996, okay, there was this Ariane 5 rocket which was sent to space. Now what had happened was, in that Ariane 5, the Ariane 5 actually collapsed and it burnt off. Okay. Now, one of the major reasons when they went to do the failure analysis, now this is something that the Western countries are very good at it. Why a particular thing failed? They go and do the failure analysis also. We don't do. In India, I mean, as a this thing, we don't do. So that was a very major loss. So when they found out, they said that up to version 4 of that Ariane 4 rocket, they had a 16-bit processor. Okay. Now, the Ariane 5 actually had a 32 or a 64-bit processor, microprocessor. And whatever code was actually running on a 16, they tried to actually put it back into the 32 or 64, whatever. And that was the major cause when they that 16 to this thing was not tested here. And that actually, that reuse of that old thing here created problem. The same thing can happen when you are actually using something in some other, OS. You may be using something in Windows. But supposing you try to reuse it in Linux, it may not work. One is the compatibility and footability issues, but then it could cause some issues which maybe, I would say the reverse. It was taken care of in Linux properly, but then it is not taken care of in Windows and things like that. Then the thing is the ever shifting threat landscape. That is, today you have actually built one algorithm, or today you have actually, that these errors are there in the software, and this is what you're going to, somebody has actually gone and cracked it, or somebody has gone and found a bug, and then you go and fix it, fine. But then, supposing you're building an encryption algorithm, okay, and you are saying that there are so many mathematicians who have built it, it is mathematically proven to be very, very correct, it can take care of these problems and things like this. It takes this much of this many computers working in parallel to break it, fine, all that is fine. Now, suppose somebody goes and cracks it. Then the fact is, if that person who has cracked it, if he is a university person or a, person who is associated with academia, he will go publish a paper and he will get his accolades. But if it is going to be a country, a state, which actually has gone, they will actually keep quiet. They will not publish it for them, because suppose I have actually made one algorithm and I've actually tested it and I'm using it, they will use that knowledge of having broken the thing. They will not reveal it, and they will try to break our whatever communication and things like that. And you imagine that the technological issues, actually the threat landscape that is always changing. We think that these are the issues in the software. Let us go and fix these problems. Okay, but the attacker, he needs only one thing to come inside. Okay, and what it is, we don't know. We will not know at all. Many times it's not possible for us to test the entire software that we build fully from end. So these are the issues that actually come in the technological realm. Okay, then I was telling you about this psychological reasons for the things coming in, confirmation trap, okay, and functional fixation. Functional fixation is like, I have put a antivirus, I have put encryption, I have put a firewall, so I am safe. I mean, you can have that, and psychologically it will give you some sort of the same. But if they are not actually configured properly, if they are not implemented and given to you properly, okay, or if they are not updated, or their things and all, then that is actually going to cause a lot of problems for you. Because at any time, remember, all these companies are going to come and sell the software to you, because they have to have their bottom line and they have a time to deliver, and they'll come and do that. And then confirmation traps. Most of the times what happens is, by default, any of these things, if you go, you want to actually say, there'll be this, do you want to continue or not? I mean, okay or cancel. Now the default, this thing will always be on the okay, or it will be on cancel, as may be the case. So these are the issues that, and without even batting an eyelid, we'll go and click. We'll not even know where the default is there. So these are some of the things that actually cause rise to these kind of problems. Now, these are kind of quite, interesting things. Design flaws which had serious repercussions. I believe way back in 1996, when Sir Tim Berners-Lee wrote this HTTP, which we all know is stateless. The issue why he went to stateless, I'll tell you, and an interesting story there. actually Unix at that time, okay, was only taking the server implementation was only taking some not more than 12 sessions. The moment you have the 13th session, it used to crash. So Tim Berners-Lee went and made this entire thing as a stateless thing, and he made it stateless. So that was a parallel thing. Now, what had happened, because it was having that issue, these Unix people went and they fixed it immediately. But then what had happened, the world has already progressed. Okay, they went and fixed it perfectly. It was taking more than 12, and it was very beautifully architected in the server of the Linux, no issues. But Tim Berners-Lee went and found this www. Now you have a stateless HTTP. Now how to, after that, we started having the boom of e-commerce. This, you actually put some things in the cart, it will vanish because of the statelessness. You come back to the page, it will not be there. You cannot have all those, you know, this cookies, cart, all these things and all came. Then you had this Ajax, Ruby, all those kind of frameworks working on that stateless HTTP. And then people started to do patch. All these things actually were actually giving a lot of, you know, issues, because you wanted to go and fix the stateless HTTP, which was already fixed because it had a root cause problem of handling not more than 12 sessions, parallel sessions. Taken care, but no, that will not be there. The other thing is the Neumann architecture. Now, what had happened was, way back when we were doing this, we had one more architecture where, I mean, this, you remember, there's this thing about this code and data to be together. Okay, now this architecture was actually not, this is from the base, the machine itself. The architecture itself was not allowing that to happen because you had to have a code separate and then the data separate. But then that's where you have all this stack buffer overflows and all. But then they was not allowing some of the things because it was very expensive and things like that. And then they made it together, and then all sorts of issues actually came. String handling in C, especially in C, that last character will be a null. Actually, why, if you ask, it is because the architecture, underlying architecture, was not allowing that to happen to something else. Had it been taken care, in fact, that null, whatever is there, that last character in string, if it was actually taken care in the architecture of C itself, many of the string formatting issues and things like that we see, we will not be in a position to, I mean, those things would have been taken care, but however, that was not the case. Okay, and I'll be almost coming to a closure now. I mean, okay, fine. Yeah, you'll all ask me, fine, ma'am, you have told all these things. What happened? I mean, I would say that all these things, somebody else did some mistake, and then in hindsight, it is very easy for us to have a 2020 vision and then tell, yeah, they could have taken care of that, they could have taken care of this and things like that. But of course, things are there. And it's better, it's having sound SDLC practices. Now, in fact, if you see, we have a subject called software engineering, but then do we really take very seriously about it? I do not know, we'll have to see. And I'm really, I mean, if we have sound practices, right from the requirements capture, and you know, you have, a solid configuration management control of your software and the documentation of it and everything, actually the process engineering for that, no, it should not be, you know, patched on like a band-aid. Okay, the security thing should be there from the beginning to the end. It cannot be, it should be a part of the baking process. It cannot be thought of as an icing on the cake. You cannot do those kind of things even in software. You cannot do that in any engineering fields. Why do you have to do for software? That is the conclusion that I wanted to actually give. And I come to the end of my talk with this last slide. And thank you for hosting me. And I think I'll be taking some questions now.
Thank you, ma'am. That was very an informative talk. I would request all the participants to post your questions in the chat box or in the question and answers session. Shall I read out the questions to you, ma'am?
Yeah, sure. I'll take, definitely.
Okay. There's one question from Raghavan. For new researchers, should they start their own coding or directly use commercial software?
See, that is the thing. No, now in open source, everything is there. You can, in fact, it will be good. And if you can have that as a parallel and you use, you see, that is where the creativity of that individual person is. Okay, if you are using if you are using an already open source available or a commercial available, your creativity in writing a piece of code which is really very well engineered, that is something going to be great. So I would actually prefer that doing it yourself because your creativity also will be there. Yeah. Hello.
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah. So I would say that it is better to have that you create your own and then learn on the process. Of course, have the since it's a research field and have the other person other parallel thing also there. No issue.
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah.
Jesuda, any other question?
I'm checking the question and answer. This one. I think there are no more questions here.
Chitra ma'am?
Yeah.
Thanks for your great talk. And I have a question on this security part because you have covered how much security. For IoT perspective, right now, which is the future of this thing? Like if you see Industry 4.0 and other things. So from IoT perspective, what will you say? Because it's not completely a software, it's a embedded kind of thing.
Yeah.
So what is your say for the new people on IoT?
See, in IoT, it is, again, we have to talk to so many, that's what I told, that extensibility when I was talking, right? In my slide, IoT is one of the things where we are talking about that extensibility, where you have a piece of software which is actually talking to not one machine but more machines, and now that is actually going to create. There's going to be a lot of security issues in that because it is not. It is not only restricted to that small space. So one of the causes of trouble, that extensibility, because we keep on extending, IoT is also going to be coming into the same way. We have to take it with a, it's a good, see, I'm not decrying the benefits of that, but it is, IoT is going to be there, it is going to be good. But at the same time, we have to see, like, for example, one of the things that it is there is like our, let us take the healthcare, where people will be taking care of their, this insulin pumps and all, which is actually sometimes embedded into the body and it is taken care. And in that, if supposing there is going to be, instead of giving this many pumping this many at any defined time, if somebody can come and crack and try to instead of giving this much less or more, then it is going to be detrimental to that particular patient's sugar levels. So yes, it is going to be, I mean, we'll have to see it with the aspect of the particular domain in which that particular software or the IoT software will be actually working.
Okay, yes, so your point. So your point is like domain is also important as well as software security is concerned. Yeah, ma'am, you are absolutely right. I agree with you. And now software is everywhere. If you see IoT, if you see all smart homes, everywhere IoT is there. Smart home, medicine, transport, everything you say, name it, and it is there. So security, this is very important topic, and we are very happy that you have covered the right from basic to this level. And we are really happy because I was behind you that we wanted to do it first.
No, it was very good that you were behind me. It actually made me also go and study a little bit also. Thanks.
So thank you, ma'am. Thanks a lot for giving it in a short notice, and you agreed for that, and you covered. And we will look in look forward for more talks like this, maybe in robotics areas and more into cryptography.
Definitely. Maybe many of my colleagues from CARE also can actually join, Reena.
Yes, ma'am, we want that, even cryptography and other. They are very important areas which are required for all the domain people. It's not only for software. It's it's because IoT is there. It is there in all the domains. So with domain expert and with the software security expert, it has to go. It cannot be done by a single person. So we need domain expertise from all.
Absolutely.
And exposure is a very good gain in exposure to all the people who are part of IEEE. And this was a name. Yes, Sadhana ma'am, over to you.
Yeah, yeah. Thank you, Reena, for arranging this excellent talk. Thank you, Mrs. Chitra, for enlightening us into the errors that creep into software. That was very informative. And some of the participants have posted, I think Padma Sai, she's the WHR Hyderabad session, she has posted excellent information. Rajkumar has posted nice sessions. The participants seem to have really benefited by your talk. So
thank you
so much for having come over here. And my association with CARE is, and Dr. Vidyasagar was the director. Oh. When you were in the near Rajbhavan.
Oh, is it? Okay.
I used to visit there almost every day for some project which we are doing it together. So I have a long association with the center.
Okay. Okay, good. Nice to know.
Now, Sula, can you conclude?
Yes, ma'am. I heartily thank our speaker for the day, Mrs. Chitra Vishwanathan from CAIR. Thank you, ma'am. That was an excellent talk. And I
thank you.
Yes, ma'am. And I thank all the participants for listening patiently throughout the webinar and for the few questions asked. I take this opportunity to thank all the members of for organizing this webinar from WIE Bangalore section. Thank you once again. And we'll meet again in the next session, which is going to be on November 28th. Please do join.
Okay.
Thank you all.
Yeah, and the next session will be radar transmitter concepts and design, a case study by Sushma Biyar. She is also a scientist from DRDO.
Yeah. Thank you all.
Thank you all.
Thank you.